Racism and activism are not mutually exclusive. Here on yourworldnews.org.
I wanted to get right to it. I've heard you and other courageous and outspoken Israeli citizens talk about how racist, you know, mentioned that Zionism is racism, which it is, and but also mentioning how racist and how pervasive racism is within Israeli society. I wanted to ask you how, you know, given that context, how are Ethiopian Jews, how are non, you know, Jewish East Africans that are, you know, that are have immigrated to Israel, how are they treated in large, how in general, how are they treated within Israel? Are they treated the same as white Israelis? What's the treatment for them?
They are treated no different than black people are treated by white colonizers anywhere around the world. When you look at what happens in the United States, how black people are treated around here in the United States by police, by law enforcement, it's exactly the same thing. In terms of opportunities, in terms of discrimination, when it comes to housing, education, jobs, you name it, there is no difference. They're treated exactly. It's a carbon copy of the way people of color are treated here in this country or any other colonizing, settler colonial project, exactly the same way. With the East Africans, now the Ethiopians are supposedly Jewish, so there is some legitimacy to their existence in Israel. There's some legitimacy to their existence in Israel. When the East Africans came as refugees, Israel wanted to show how magnanimous it was and accepted them as asylum seekers, to show how magnanimous it was. But then public opinion, you know, this is years ago. This is several decades ago. Now these people, they've kind of become Israelis. Their kids go to school. Some of them even serve in the military. You know, they have families. They've been there for, you know, there's like second, third generation. And suddenly Israelis are saying, wait, what are all these black people who are not Jewish doing in our country? You know, send them away. And so the mood shifted, which was expected, should have been expected, because it's a racist society and racist societies are racist societies. That's the way they are. There's no way they were going to accept a whole bunch of black asylum seekers from Africa, even though they do all the dirty work, which is very convenient. But they do all the dirty work and then they have to hide from the police and the immigration authorities after they do the dirty work because they're going to get kicked out. So that's how, you know, I mean, the settler colonial state, it's a racist state. They're treated, again, the Ethiopians, there's legitimacy to their existence. The other Africans who came as asylum seekers, there's no legitimacy to their existence. So now, particularly every time there's an election cycle, and there's a fourth election cycle in a period of 2 years, it's coming up, it just started. There's gonna be elections again in March. This is one of the issues. If you follow, as I do, the Israeli politicians, one of the issues is we're going to get rid of these asylum seekers. We're going to get rid of this plague, you know, of these people. That's how they're treated.
Thank you. And you also mentioned there's a connection, sort of parallels between the way that East African Jewish people and Arabs are treated in Israel and then how Black people and other people of color in this country are treated in the United States. And that reminds me a little bit about the movement to end the deadly exchange. So the connections between the military industrial complex and the prison industrial complex in both the US and in Israel. And we know a little bit about how United States policemen are sent to Israel for training and that a lot of the tear gas and weaponry that's used in the United States is also used in Israel. And so I'd love to hear your thoughts on the movement to end the deadly exchange and how you see that growing and where it's going.
You know, there's this myth in America that somehow Israel is this expert at fighting terrorism and fighting crime. You know, it's almost like they look at the Israeli when you mention the Israeli military or the Mossad or any of the Israeli security apparatus, people in America just, you know, they shiver with admiration. Why? I don't know. Israel, you know, there's no justification for that whatsoever. Israel has always fought a people mostly that have never had a military. I mean, Palestinians have never had an army. Palestinians have never had a tank. I mean, there's never been a threat from Palestinians. So killing them and so forth is really not a big challenge. It's not a big deal, considering Israel has got such an enormous military. But that's part of it. And then here in the United States, you've got this several very racist Zionist entities. Probably the most well-known is the ADL, the Anti-Defamation League, which is a racist, violence-supporting, vile organization that pretends to be a civil rights organization. And there's a really good campaign going on now, Drop the ADL, because the ADL is not a friend of progressives. And the ADL has been pushing, and other organizations have been paying for this deadly exchange, which is to send police chiefs and police officers and other law enforcement to Israel to be trained by the Israelis. And to them, this is some big heroic, you know, accomplishment. It's terrible. It's horrifying. It's absolutely horrifying that they think it's okay to send law enforcement to one of the most racist, violent states in the world to learn. You know, Israel trained some of the most, some of the darkest, most violent dictatorships around the world, their militaries and their secret police, the Shah of Iran, the dictatorships in Latin America. After the assassination of Patrice Lumumba in the Congo, you know, they trained Mobutu and others, Idi Amin. I mean, the list goes on and on and on, okay? And now they're training law enforcement, American law enforcement. You know, what does that say about the United States? And I think it also, there's another aspect to besides this admiration for the American military, for the Israeli military and the security apparatus. And there's a legitimacy to it. There's a sense of legitimacy. You know, Joe Biden can say, I'm a Zionist. And he doesn't understand what he's saying. It's who would want to identify with a white supremacist, racist, violent ideology like that and be proud of it? How do you get away with it?
Exactly.
You know, I mean, we're talking about the Proud Boys. The Proud Boys are amateurs compared to Zionism. You know what I mean? That's all part of it. It's the sense that there's a legitimacy to Zionism, to the Israeli military, to this apparatus that is fighting terrorism, and they're fighting like us against the same forces of evil and so on. And I think that's a big problem here in America, that there is this legitimacy to Israel and to Zionism.